If you love liberty, declare your independence by signing the Shire Society Declaration at shiresociety.com.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, and good afternoon to you all. I hope that you receive the information that I just gave you in just a few minutes, because what I just gave you doesn't pertain to what we're going to discuss in the next few minutes. For the record, I'm Dick Wapple of Hooksett, representing Merrimack District 24. This is my fifth term, and what you have before you is what has arisen as a result of the administration of this state stating that the bonds that all public servants are required to have under our statutes are not accessible by the people. Well, this is a little bit of a difficulty, at least with me. It's like paying for insurance premium and not getting the benefit of it. So the argument is, we have a board of claims. We don't need a board of claims. It should be eliminated. And the bonding companies do the investigation. Then you have an impartial investigation of the claim that is being made against the public servant. The bonding company, for which is being paid a premium, are the ones that should do the investigation. And they will make the determination as to whether the claim is a legitimate claim or a fraudulent claim. And the bonding companies, and I can't find the law to support it, but I understand that any public servant whose a claim is made, they are obligated to present that claim to the bonding company. If they don't, I think, and this is where I think I would have to verify it, and you can verify it, it is considered obstruction of justice, because the citizen is being denied the right to have the bonding company make an investigation and determine whether or not that public servant is in violation of whatever the claim is that's being made. But I think, Mr. Tackett, you wrote the blurb last time on it, and I'm not directing this particularly at you, but you mentioned the state, what do you got, claims, whatever it is. I don't think that should even exist as a standing committee, the Committee for Claims, because it's not your function to determine whether the citizens, I don't mean you as an individual, I'm talking about the committee. It's not their determination, because it's a perception of conflict of interest in protecting the employees. We are not employees. We are elected officials. That's another issue that I have, and which is another issue that is in another department. But we have a difference between public officials and public employees. And public employees are required to have a bond. Now, it's all, maybe this committee may make a determination that, okay, everybody that comes to work and gets the benefit of working for this corporation we call the state of New Hampshire, if they get the benefit of working, well, maybe they should pay for their own. Maybe they should pay for their own premium on the bond that they are required to close. That's an option. Why should the general public have to pay a premium and then not have access to it? And that's what the issue is. I think I did 3 to 5 minutes. I'll confine myself to that, unless there's some questions.
Okay. Are there questions? Yes, sir, from the side, Jack.
I just want to say, Representative Marshall, Marple, I definitely did write the blurb, but that wasn't the gravamen of why, of the substance of the recap. There were other issues, and I'm not sure you have yet addressed them, but that, I'm going to save all that for the executive session, because this isn't really the forum for debate. So I just want to mention that. You're welcome to come to the executive session to hear me.
Well, thank you for elaborating on that. Was it Internal Revenue that you mentioned?
It was, the real problem was that we could not, the testimony that we heard, and I think that we will hear again, is that there were two things. The bonding company isn't in a position to do this kind of investigating, but more to the point, they would not issue. We could not get bonds issued under the circumstances of the previous bill. So it was an impossible situation that you were putting, that the bill would have put the state into. And that needs to be addressed before we can move forward with your intention.
Just out of my curiosity, does the current bill meet with the necessity that you just mentioned?
We will hear that, if I may.
Yes.
We will hear that when, from this, probably the next testifier, who I believe is, represents a bonding company. I'm not certain of that, but we will be hearing from a bonding company. And we need that barrier, that objection met, because it's a practical matter. The state can't be one of 50 that isn't bonded. That's just not, that's too serious a public policy issue to undertake with this bill. So that needs to be addressed, regardless of your intention, that be as a practical matter. It's like a car without wheels.
Representative Brewster, you have a question?
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Dick. Is the state required, I know under statute they're required to have bonding, and if there's a bonding person here, I guess we are bonded, but my understanding, especially with the judicial judges, that they should be bonded more so, and I don't think, are they covered underneath the bond, with a bond?
I, she's no longer with us. She's been replaced by a new director of administration. This is going back a couple of years ago. I sent a letter, and she responded to me. I spoke with her, and she sent a letter to me. And she says, the bonding company does not provide coverage for the citizen who's paying the premium. The bonding company only provides coverage for the corporation doing business as the state of New Hampshire. So it's a... what do you want to call it? An inside deal. The only one who's named in the policy is the state of New Hampshire, not the public. And I find that difficult to accept.
Follow up.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So, say if somebody sues the state, does the bonding company pick that up? The price of that? Does that go through when... take like the disabled, they're suing right now, and if they win their case, will the bonding company pay?
It's my understanding that all public servants are bonded, but they're only bonded with to the corporation as a beneficiary. Corporation's a beneficiary, not the public. And that's what this issue is all about, because it's the public that are paying the premium on the bond. The protection, so now we only have protection for the corporation doing business as the state. So that's what the issue is. The issue is the public, the general public, the taxpayers, are paying for something that they don't get. And regardless of what the financial impact is, that's why this committee here has the latitude to move within this committee to change anything that is there necessary to protect the public. The public is right to remain. That's what bonding companies are supposed to do. They make the investigation. They make the determination of whether or not the claim that has been submitted is a valid claim. If it's fraudulent, they can bring perjury charges, because every claim has to be submitted under a notary public. So someone who is going to extend their civil liability on an affidavit, I don't think they're going to risk the, become a victim of being a perjury, and that's what it would be. So an affidavit of claim submitted to whoever should go to the bonding company. The bonding company is charged to make an investigation and a determination. And as it was written here in today's proposal, the bonding company, if they determine that a payment it should be made, and they make the payment, then the bonding company can recover under subrogation against the guilty public servant that was proven guilty of whatever the claim was. So there's a penalty on the public servant. Now there's no penalty. They can get away with doing whatever they want and ignore it because the public doesn't have the opportunity to have an independent, not as Mr. Stichek suggested here with his, I forgot the name of it, what is it, the Department of, what is it? Committee of Claims or whatever it is that he set up. That has a perception of being conflict of interest because you've got public servants protecting other public servants. With a bonding company, you don't have that risk.
Thank you.
Does that cover it?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? All right, thank you very much, Representative Markle. Lindsay Nava.
I welcome anybody's verification of the citations that I've used.
You could just pass those extra.
We're pretty helpful committee. We'll pass them right around.
There you go. All right. I only got a couple more. I got them again. Thank you. That's not my number.
Committee members, I'm Lindsay Nato, here representing the American Insurance Association. I do have written testimony, which you can go over in more detail, so I will try to keep it brief, and I'm happy to take any questions. I must admit, George Roussos often handles this subject, and I am filling in for him, so if I'm not able to answer any of your questions, I'd be happy to get those answers for you subsequently. Essentially, AIA, the American Insurance Association, has concerns with this bill because, as you'll know, the purpose of the requirements of having statutory bonds is to secure state and counties and towns from losses resulting from any sort of public officials' failure to perform their job duties. So I think you need to consider that that's the overall purpose, is really to protect those sort of public revenues. One of the more common examples is, you know, when the budgets obviously depend on taxes being collected. And public entities can make a claim on a public bond, for example, if the tax collector doesn't remit all the taxes that he or she has collected. That's just one example. So then the surety responds and pays valid claims up to the sum of the bond. What this bill would permit would be for private citizens to unpredictably deplete the amount of the bond, and that would then impact the protections afforded by the bond for the public entity. We also have concerns, as was mentioned, the bonding company really isn't equipped to do this type of an investigation with private, if private claims are brought on the bond. It would substantially increase the time and the type of work spent in doing investigations, which would likely increase premiums. There'd also be costs with trying to defend against these sort of claims. It also would be harder to underwrite bonds. Bonds typically are based on a variety of factors. It's often a case-by-case basis, depending on the position and the person's background, their history of honesty, competence, and compliance. And so based on those factors, the underwriters look at those factors when doing the bond. And with the sort of unknown of what private actions might be brought against the bond, there's really just no way to sort of underwrite what that risk would be. Which I think is what Representative Sitek was addressing. We do feel that private citizens do have remedies at law currently. They can bring claims against public officials for injuries and damages that they suffer. They can pursue claims against the appropriate public entity. We don't believe that their remedy should include going against the bond itself. That's really just not the purpose of the bond. And I'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just to make sure that to answer, I think, the issues with Representative Markle, a private citizen can sue a public official, which is covered under the bond for damages or whatever, for whatever reason, whatever legitimate reason, and receive compensation for those damages, whatever they are. So would you agree that essentially that the private citizen is indeed getting compensation from the bonds that we are paying for? Or could get.
If I'm understanding the way you're wording it, I think you are correct, if I'm understanding it correctly. That the, the private citizen who believes that they're wronged by a public official can make a claim against the public official or against the municipality. The purpose of the bond is for when the municipality or the county or the state suffers any loss because of their employees' wrongdoing, that they don't lose that revenue, and the bond is there to support them.
Well, I guess it's just a quick follow-up. But if I deem that I'm wronged by, let's say the county, not that we have one necessarily, a county tax collector, then as a private citizen, I can file suit against the county tax collector, and the county tax collector, if found guilty, is going to pay me through the bonds whatever damages are awarded.
Right, then your municipality would get the bond. Well, so essentially, yes.
Therefore,
they're getting that benefit.
To answer the problem that Representative Markle is bringing forth, I believe, is that indeed, a private citizen can, in a fashion, not directly, but in a fashion, sue and get compensation from the bonding.
They indirectly can get that benefit.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As a victim myself, witnessing too many other citizens being victimized by Health and Human Services, even including all the patients that was up in Effingham, and what a mess that was with the question is, what avenues is it? I just never saw an avenue for me or any other victims to move forward. I haven't seen nothing out there. There's no law against official oppression. Where can citizens bring their claims? I don't see an avenue, personally.
I think that the proper venue for those sorts of claims would be in the courthouse and bringing actions against the public official or their employer.
Another question? Just in my particular case, I did try to go to court. I did have to pay for the court fees and the sheriff's fees, but they did not deliver the summons, so I was stonewalled, so I couldn't move ahead. Nothing forces somebody to give a state employee
question?
Question. Is there any help for the citizen?
Are you sure she doesn't know that answer?
No, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chair. I was just trying to puzzle out how most insurance works, if liability insurance, because that's truly what a bond is in many respects, is it not?
It can be, yeah.
Mm. And so you would sue the entity covered by that, wouldn't you? And then that's where it's purchased it, it becomes payable to the purchaser.
Right.
It doesn't strike me as any different than any kind of similar product.
I don't think it's that much different. I think the main difference when you're looking at, for example, different types of insurance with your public employee bonds is that, unlike most insurance, when the claim is paid out, the surety bond company can go after that public employee versus like another insurance when claims are paid and you just pay the premium and then there's nothing paid out after that to the surety. So I think that's the main difference. But in terms of sort of, you know, contractual liability, it does work similar to that.
Thank you.
No, Representative Bowden. Thank you, Madam Chair. And thanks for taking my question. And this is more a matter of personal curiosity, so if you could just make the answer very brief so we don't waste the committee's time. In the case of a municipal employee embezzling funds from the city, would the bond surety agent reimburse the town or municipality for their loss?
In that sort of example, yes, if the town suffers a loss because of that embezzlement, they would make a claim to the surety, and the surety would pay that claim up to the amount of the bond. If it's over that, they wouldn't pay over.
Thank you. Thank you for your indulgence.
All right, thank you. Other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Does anyone else wish to speak on House Bill 204? All right, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. The next one is on House Bill 618. And it will be.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.